My name is Jamie Logue. I'm Director of Development at the Council of Canadians.
Okay, Ani. Like you said, I'm from the Mississaugas of the New Credit First Nation. The city adjacent to us is named after our First Nation. But really, this is mostly where our home was. And for those who are Toronto-centric, you know, we just settled the 1805 Toronto Purchase, which was over 200 years to realize that there was some wrongdoing there. But there's a lot of things about Toronto that still are very much of interest to us, especially the water. And so on behalf of our First Nation, who consider this their traditional territory and their ancestral home, I want to welcome you to our land, and that we hope that the work that you're doing will help us and help everyone protect the water. And as a woman in our Anishinaabe traditions, the woman is sort of in charge of the water because she gives birth. And we do often come here in Toronto to do a water ceremony.
Well, we've got as you can see, a phenomenal lineup of speakers tonight, and we're going to be not only inspired by their work and their words, but we're all going to join together at some point to take some collective action around the Great Lakes. So it's going to be a great evening, and there's going to be an opportunity near the end of the night for question and answer. Right before we get started, just some quick housekeeping items. First, if I can direct your attention just outside the doors, the information table, please help yourself to the various reports and materials that we've made available to you. These are really great resources that you can use, you can take with you, and you can share with your friends and family and with your networks of activists working to address the various threats to the Great Lakes. Also available is Maude Barlow's excellent report on the Great Lakes. I can't recommend this highly enough. If you care about the Great Lakes, if you're concerned about what's happening, this report, Our Great Lakes Commons, A People's Plan to Protect the Great Lakes Forever, is a must read. It's available in the lobby for $10, and all proceeds from the sale of the report will go to funding the great work of the Council of Canadians, and specifically our work on the Great Lakes. So I highly recommend that as well. Please pick one up on your way out. They have various statements like, I support the Great Lakes Commons, the Great Lakes are blank, you know, my Great Lakes promise. I'm sure all of you, after hearing tonight's speakers, have your own sentiments and reflections on what the Great Lakes mean to you. I encourage you to take out a pen, and there's pens available at the information table outside. Fill out your water drop and drop it in the bucket on the way out. And it may just feel like one drop in the bucket, but we're collecting thousands of these water drops over the course of the tour and moving forward into the next leg of our tour, which we're hoping to launch next year. And we're going to take all of these, and we're going to knit them together. Well, not maybe not physically knit them together. We'll knit them. We'll take them. We'll staple them. The idea is to amass all these water drops in a powerful public display of just how strongly the public supports meaningful action on the Great Lakes and how much we want to be part of a new vision for the lakes. So please fill out your drops and drop them off on your way out. And just a final plug for our Great Lakes Commons, Maude Barlow's report. This is an excellent read. It's a must-have. It's also available in the lobby for $10. And again, all of the proceeds from the sales of the report go to furthering the council's work. So thank you very much. What we'd like to do is, you know, one of the distinctions of the Council of Canadians is, you know, we're a registered not-for-profit. And we adhere to the same principles and standards and accountability of a registered charity, but because of our advocacy work, the federal government does not consider our work to be charitable in nature. And you may be aware of the Harper government's recent crackdown on registered charities and putting a chill across them in terms of how much of their work they can dedicate to advocacy work.
Wow. Thank you, Jamie. Thank you very much, Jamie, and thank you all for being here on this gorgeous night. I know there have been very few summer nights, and we were kind of worried everybody would be out biking or whatever, so maybe you biked here, but thank you so much, and thank you for making the trip out here. We thought that being right here on these lakes would be extraordinarily important in terms of making the connection. This is the first night of phase one of a long tour, I believe. And a campaign for us to have a much broader look at how we can save the Great Lakes that we love. And I want to thank Carolyn for that beautiful opening, and also to be on the panel with Mark from Ontario Waterkeepers, Kevin, who's done this wonderful film on the Great Lakes Waterlife, and Kathleen from the Chiefs of Ontario. You're in for a real treat. And I do want to say thanks to Jamie and for emceeing. And tonight we also have Mark Calzavera, Marianne Adranji, and Gary Neal from the Council of Canadians, all part of our team. So we're all just absolutely thrilled to be here. And a big special shout out and thank you to the Toronto chapter. You guys are amazing. You do wonderful work. And you amaze me at all times. I just want to take 1 second to remind us that when we're sitting here looking out at this beautiful lake, and we could be on any of the lakes, in fact, the lakes are one lake as we know, but anywhere around the Great Lakes, it's really hard to kind of grasp that we do in fact have a global water crisis and that we are a planet running out of fresh, available fresh water. And there are many reasons for that, and if I start going into it, you'll never hear me talk about the Great Lakes, so I won't. I will only just say that a recent study by the big water guzzling industries, bottled water and food and so on, have declared that by 2030, which is not very far away, our demand for water will outstrip supply by 40%. So we are really, really living in a world where we have taken the world's available fresh water, we're either polluting it, displacing it, or mismanaging it. In many cases, dumping it in the ocean when we're finished with it. So it's very important for us, when we are blessed with having a water system like this, that we understand that we are stewards of it and we have a responsibility. So I just want to start by saying that, but to say also that although Canadians think we love our water heritage and it's in our culture and it's in our music and it's in our stories and poetry and so on, we actually have very poor laws. We take our water for granted. We have what I call the myth of abundance. We just can't imagine that there could ever be anything permanent that could go wrong with these lakes. Our National Water Act, with a few amendments, is 42 years old and totally inadequate. So we are not doing a good job to begin with. But there are many threats. So the Great Lakes of North America, of course, form the largest group of freshwater lakes in the world. It's an incredible inheritance and an incredible responsibility. There have been, over the years, many joint projects to fix parts of the problem, banning of DDT, PCBs, the fight against acid rain, the fight to reduce at least the dead zone, the once famous dead zone of Lake Erie. And there are many wonderful environmental, First Nations, community groups, officials all around the lakes who have worked for many, many years trying to protect the lakes. But it's simply not enough, and that's what we're here to say tonight, and that's what this campaign is about. There are so many threats to the lakes that continue, and in fact there are new ones. We have climate change with dropping water levels. We know that the ice cover has gone down 70% in the last few decades. We have massive pollution from so many sources, 204 toxic pollutants in the lake. Untreated sewage runoff, some of it right from here in Toronto, bunker oil, nuclear waste from over 30 reactors on the shores, massive chemical contaminants from agribusiness. We have 43 what are called areas of concern, which are areas that are just toxic to people and nature in their area. We've lost so much of our wetland cover, about two-thirds in the lower Great Lakes. We have 185 current invasive species, and there have been 30 virulent new species that have been identified as threatening the lakes. They haven't yet reached the lakes, but you know, they're on their way kind of thing. And then we have new and former oil and gas exploration. There are 2,200 gas wells that have been drilled under Canada's portion of Lake Erie. We have 17 refineries on the US side that are actually now refining or about to refine Canada's tar sands oil. Most people think the Keystone pipeline was the only one, but no, we're already shipping Great Lakes this kind of heavy bitumen from northern Alberta to the Great Lakes. Fracking, we have massive deposits along Lake Erie, and there are now plans to just discharge on the American side, to discharge fracking effluent through the Niagara and the Niagara Falls on the U.S. side through their wastewater system, which would then lead it into the Niagara River and Lake Ontario.
There's been a giant copper and nickel ore find on the U.S. side, and the U.S. government has given the go-ahead for exploration on this massive site. And we have over-extraction, and I think this is the one that I kind of, in a way, worry about the most, because we are taking more water from the lakes every day than we are collectively putting back. There are bore wells around the Great Lakes that go as deep into the ground as Chicago skyscrapers go into the sky. And so we are also seeing virtual water exports from the massive agribusiness that is using water on the lake, so that the water that's used to produce commodities and so on is actually shipped away. There was a recent study on groundwater around the world. They didn't study the Great Lakes, but they said that if the Great Lakes groundwater is being pumped at the same intensity as global groundwater pumping, the Great Lakes could be bone dry in 80 years, which is a stunning statistic. Doug Hafner of the University of Windsor, who's a leading scientific authority on the Great Lakes, says we are now on a crisis pathway. Something is going to collapse. Now, how has it come to this when we do have all these agreements on water quality, on fisheries, and so on? Well, partially because we deal with most of these issues separately, both as issues but also in so many jurisdictions. But I think the larger issue is that we have dueling visions of what the Great Lakes are and what they're for and who they serve. While some see them as a precious watershed that gives us life and livelihood, that need to be protected at all costs, others see the Great Lakes as a great big dollar sign, the industrial engine of North America, and our resource to be used for our pleasure, profit, and convenience. From its earliest history of European settlement, the story of the Great Lakes has been one of steady exploitation. The St. Lawrence Seaway, in fact, was opened up in 1959 for the express purpose of expanding industrial production and trade, and it served economic goals almost to the total exclusion of others. The Great Lakes waters were seen as a commodity to promote commercial enterprise and economic prosperity, and used as a dumping ground for manufacturing industries such as steel, paper, petrochemical, and auto, at the cost of their health and long-term sustainability. And now the North American energy grid, the integration of our energy grid, threatens the Great Lakes in another way. Great Lakes United says that the big energy companies now view the lake beds of the Great Lakes as a new frontier for the routing of cross-lake oil and gas pipelines and electric transmission lines. As I said, tar sands oil, which is the dirtiest, most corrosive oil on Earth, is being pumped through pipes along Lakes Superior, Michigan, Huron, and Erie, and one even runs through under the St. Clair River, which drains into Lake St. Clair, Lake Erie, and the Detroit River. And there are always spills with this heavy bitumen, this corrosive crude. The Great Lakes Basin region now has a gross regional product of $4.2 trillion. If it stood alone as a country, the region would have the second biggest economy in the world. And I think too many of our governments and too many of our politicians just cannot get past this reality, that that's how they see these lakes. Ontario clearly intends with its Water Opportunities Act and another act called WaterTAP, which is Water Technology Acceleration Partnership, to use Ontario's water resources to entice industry and water technology industry into the area. As it is, industry in Ontario, including bottled water companies, only pay $3.71 for a million liters of raw water. You can imagine what they're earning from that water, right? Milwaukee City Council is promoting something called WAVE, Water Attracting Valued Customers, and will give cheaper water rates to water-guzzling industries that move from other parched areas of the United States. And the proof is in the pudding. The proof is in what amount of money we put into keeping these lakes safe. The federal government puts in about $50 million a year, compared to about $300 million on the U.S. side. So we put in about a sixth of what the U.S. does, and we are arguably actually contaminating at a greater rate than the Americans. The Ontario government has said recently that they would up the amount for cleanup to $52 million, but we have yet to see a cent of that. Plus, of course, we have the budget bill that's before Parliament right now that's so thick that it just takes you days just to get through the thing. Among many egregious pieces of that budget act is a change to the Fisheries Act, which is taking habitat away from the Fisheries Act. So this is a whole new threat to the lakes that we haven't had before. So what's the solution? We at the Council of Canadians are a citizen-based movement, and we've been working with a number of American and Canadian and First Nations groups concerned about the lakes to think and to think about what people who live around them and love them can do. So many people say, I agree with everything you said, but I feel absolutely helpless to do anything. So we asked ourselves the question, what might happen if the citizens of this region decided to stop waiting for their politicians and decided to collectively protect the Great Lakes based on the very principles and practices that informed the First Peoples of this region, namely that the lakes must be shared equitably and protected responsibly by all who live on them for seven generations to come. So what we are proposing is a new narrative that declares the Great Lakes to be a lived commons, that is a common heritage that belongs to all and must be shared carefully, managed and enjoyed by all, not a privileged few. As a commons, these waters would be considered a human right and a public resource, and local communities would have a much greater say in all decisions affecting their local watershed. We're also recommending that we recognize the doctrine of public trust, which protects the Great Lakes Commons Basin in law, and would reject the view that the primary function of the Great Lakes is to promote the industry, the interests of industry at the cost of all else. Public trust law would embrace the belief that the lakes must be equitably shared and carefully governed for the good of the whole community. It would also clarify that private interests are subordinate to community rights. We also want the Great Lakes Basin's common to be named a protected bioregion, with an understanding, while that there are currently many political jurisdictions governing the lakes, it is in fact one integrated watershed and must be governed one day as such. As a protected bioregion, it would be understood that the Great Lakes watershed itself and its species and habitat actually have rights beyond their usefulness to us and need to be protected in law. A lot of us are talking about the rights of nature, finding ways to make our human laws more compatible with the laws of nature. And any of you interested in following this up, I'd recommend a book by Cormac Cullinan called Wild Law. He's a South African lawyer, leader, wonderful writer. And he says that in the future, generations will look back on the way we treated the environment and other species, the way we look back and see slavery. And I know that may sound like a strong statement, but he feels that, and I agree with him, that with time, we will be judged badly for how we have treated the gifts that we have been given here. Under a commons regime, all activity, public and private, would come under strict public oversight and accountability, and it would operate within a mandate whose goals are the restoration and preservation of the waters of the basin, as well as water justice for all who live around it. What we need, all of us living in these many different political jurisdictions around the lakes, is a cohesive and common analysis of the crisis facing the lakes, a common narrative to guide us through this journey, and a common set of goals to unite us as we move forward. We also believe that we need basin-wide consistent laws, regulations, and definitions to protect and expand the existing public trust laws, and we must demand eventually the supremacy of that framework over the failing current one.